We're on a mission from God.
And now for something completely different.
Good morning and happy Saturday, everyone. As you're listening to KFUO Radio, and this is Wrestling with the Basics, I'm Pastor Matt Youngblood Clark from Ascension Lutheran Church in St. Louis, Missouri.
And I'm Pastor Jolly John Lekumsky from St. Paul's Lutheran Church in New Athens, Illinois, and Trinity Lutheran Church in Darmstadt, Illinois. One of the many, many, many churches of the Lutheran Church of Missouri Synod named Trinity.
Trinity.
I did not know that.
There aren't many named Ascension.
You know
what? That's toward the bottom of the list.
Well, yeah, because there's lots of St. Paul's. In fact, I think just in my neighborhood, there's like three or four other St. Paul Lutherans. But you're right. I don't know of any other Ascensions in Illinois or over here in Missouri.
They are few and far between. Not many.
And yet, you know, when I go to a lot of churches, a lot of them will have the picture of the Ascension up there in the front. Do you have the picture of the Ascension?
We do. Yeah, thankfully we do.
So because Trinity does. Trinity has a picture of the Ascension. Yeah. St. Paul doesn't have a picture, so we...
Yeah, a couple here in St. Louis I know have the Ascension, even there, right above the altar.
Yeah.
But no, thankfully we do. I think that's awesome because it's that nice visual about what their church namesake is all about. You know, isn't there like an Ascension insurance, like health insurance or something? That's not us. No, we're the church. What about Jesus'
Ascension?
You get
a lot of calls from people asking for car insurance.
Wrong number. But no, it keeps the focus on Christ and his Ascension. And I love how his nail-pierced hands and feet
are cool
still
in
right
that picture.
There. Yeah, in that stained glass window. He's crucified, risen, now ascended too.
And you know, the irony of that is as he's ascending, he said to his disciples, I'll always be with you till the end of the age. Isn't that something?
Yeah. And last week we talked about the Holy Spirit and that promise too, as he ascends, that he's not going to leave him alone. Yeah,
no.
He's with him, like you said, but he's also sending the Helper. He's sending the Holy Spirit. Who's with them and even in them, as Jesus says.
Could I start today with a little with an amusing anecdote? Would that be okay?
Please do.
Anecdote.
Wouldn't it be Wrestling with the Basics without one?
Well, the reason I wanted to do this is because my wife and I are going to celebrate our 15th wedding anniversary this week. Yeah.
Congratulations. 15 years.
How about you?
We are celebrating our 15th wedding anniversary at the end of the month.
Yeah.
June the 29th.
All right. And we're one day after you, June 30th.
Isn't
that amazing?
So we got married on a Saturday. You got married on a Sunday.
Yep. We did. That's right. It was part of our Sunday morning church service. That's really strange to think. So you were, who would have known?
Who would have known? That's before we even knew each other.
Do you feel like maybe you're rubbing off on your wife? Maybe she's starting to pick up some of your...
She's rubbing off on me.
Is she? Well, that would be good. This would be a positive thing, because I know your wife. She's such a sweetheart. But I'm worried that I'm maybe warping my wife.
Uh-oh.
I'm not so sure, because...
A bad influence on Lynn.
That's the word. Thank you. Perfect. That's a bad influence. Because, you know, I have this kind of odd sense of humor. So this last week, have you ever gone to Rooster in town? And St. Louis?
Yes, I have. A breakfast place?
It's a chain called Rooster.
Yeah,
and they've got crepes and omelets and stuff like that.
Stuff. Yeah.
So anyway, I'm taking her to Rooster, first time to Rooster, and she doesn't know about Rooster. And I say, yeah, they tell me, Lynn, that it's got the best Rooster in all of St. Louis. If you're looking for Rooster, you can't go any better if you want to eat Rooster.
You
want
to
Yeah. And she says, without a beat, without hesitation, she says, yeah, I hear it tastes a lot like chicken.
Holy cow.
Sweetheart, happy anniversary.
Chicken.
I do love you. And so I'm she's, you know, she's out talking me now. She's out joking me. How could that be?
No.
I'm Jolly John, but she's always got one more line.
Look at that. You've worn off on her.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yep. She's always got
created
one more.
A monster. We don't need two Jolly Johns.
No,
Lynn,
no.
Fight back.
Last week, Mitt. Hi, Mitt. How you doing? How many years have we been doing this? I don't even remember your name. Matt. We had a passage from John with some difficult Bible passages.
Yes, we did.
And you think that'd be enough for you, but you actually want to take upon an even more difficult Bible passage today.
Glutton
you tell me.
For punishment. Yeah. No. Well, this is one that I don't know if this is the case for you, but when people are kind of maybe new to the Apostles' Creed.
Yeah.
Maybe they're just sort of learning what the Apostles' Creed is about. And in our new member class over at Ascension, when people are interested in joining, when we talk about Jesus, we usually walk through the Creed. I think that's a good
place.
It hits the highlights. It's a good starting place. But when we get to that point in the Creed where it talks about Jesus descending
into
hell. So we talk about he crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day, he rose again from the dead. And people almost without fail raise their hand and say, Pastor, wait a second.
Yeah, what's that all about?
What's this descent into hell stuff all about? I think it's a common question. Oh, first, what is this descent into hell? You know, did this really happen even? Where do we get this from? It's in the Creed. Is it in the Bible, though? And then second, well, why? What's the deal? Why, if Jesus did go into hell, why in the world would he go into hell?
I think that's the big question. Yeah. Why did he go? It's a peculiar thing to start off with. But yeah, you're going to actually show us the Bible passage where that happens. Yes. But yeah, why? But okay.
So I'd like to first start off with a little quote from the musical genius Meatloaf. I'm not sure what is his first name or last name. I'm not sure.
I think it's like Madonna.
Meatloaf?
Just, no, it's just Meatloaf.
Because I think it was, just one name.
Yeah.
Cher, Madonna.
Cher, Madonna, yeah.
Prince.
Yeah. When you've arrived, it's just Meatloaf.
Was that Mr. Loaf? First name Meat. Okay. I think he's the one who sang this, but that one, the love ballad in the early 90s, I would do anything for love. And there's this in the refrain, he says, I would do anything for love. I would run to hell and back.
Ah, okay.
You know, well, I mean, that singer, Meatloaf, is just being figurative, right? You know, first, does he really love someone enough to seriously go into hell for someone?
No, I
don't know.
I don't want to steal your thunder, but, you know, that is exactly what the Apostle Paul said.
What?
That he would be willing to go to hell.
Yeah, well, maybe that's where Meatloaf got that.
Maybe he got it. Who knew it was actually a biblical reference?
Yeah, look at that. The theologian Meatloaf.
Yeah.
Well, okay, so my first question is Meatloaf willing to really go to hell and back? Would we be willing of love for someone to go to hell and back? And then second, even if he is willing, is Meatloaf or the Apostle Paul, even for that matter, able to do that to go to hell and back?
Yeah.
So are you really willing to do that? Are you really able to do that? And the thing of it is, the answer is yes on both accounts.
Yeah.
He really is willing to go to hell and back for us out of love for us. And he's really able to do it too, because after all, he's the Son of God. Yeah.
You know, that's interesting. I'm going to take you off on a sidelight here.
Sure.
But of course, what I'm referring to is the passage where Paul says that if he thought it could benefit of his brothers, that he would.
Yeah.
He would be willing to go.
That. Yeah, that's a bold statement.
Wow, and it just shows how much he really did love these people. But I think you've got a point. I don't know that Paul would have thought he could get, although maybe he did. Maybe he thought in Jesus he could come back. I don't know. I'm just wondering, you know, whether he thought he could go down and come back, or whether he thought, I just love you enough, I would be willing to do that, to go.
And if he did, I mean, would it do anyone any good?
No, it wouldn't do any good.
No, and I think maybe,
because he's the worst of sinners. That's what he said.
Sinners,
yeah.
You know, and he's a human being just like us. But if God and man goes to hell and back, who's without sin, that makes a difference. Just like Jesus' death on the cross, that makes all the difference. Paul's death, that wouldn't do any good for anyone. My death wouldn't be doing any good, or your death. But if it's Jesus, if it's God himself who dies, that changes things.
You know, though, I appreciate that, because now I understand what Paul's saying. Christ says we love because he first loved us.
Yes.
And that's what Paul says.
Yeah.
My love for you is so great. Yeah. If it would help you, I would go to hell. But you're right. It would not save you. I would do that because I love you, but that would not bring you salvation, because I'm the worst of sinners. I would get down to hell and everyone would say, well, this is where you belong. This is no big surprise.
Welcome here.
Welcome
of us,
home.
Even the Apostle Paul on his own. That's where he belongs.
So,
but not Jesus.
No.
Yeah. All right. Well, let's take a look. So as I as I said, we look at the creed, okay? And so we're looking at the creed, and when you're talking about Jesus in the creed, that second part, the second article of the creed, we can sort of divide it into two different parts, all right? Jesus' state of humiliation, okay? His humbleness, we might say, where he doesn't use or he doesn't choose to use his divine power, right. God. And that state of exaltation where Jesus, he's exalted. Where Jesus does use his divine power, where he does use that authority, right? So we read the words of the creed, and I think it's pretty clear what falls into what, right? So humiliation.
Oh, then, is it there?
For the most part.
Mr. Matt.
Not Mr. Matt anymore.
Yeah, well, but not a single name we still have to use.
Yeah, instead of not just the Matt.
The Matt.
Like meatloaf.
Yeah.
Oh. Okay.
Because, well, I'm going to interrupt you because, first of all, we need to talk about this humiliation and exaltation thing that you're talking about.
Good.
Because I actually missed that on my theological exam. It's one of the questions I missed on my theological.
Wait a second.
That's right. And it bugged me so much that I still remember it 39 years later. So here was the question. We'll see how you do. Jesus' humiliation consisted in that he was a man. His humiliation consisted in that he was a man.
Well, not in and of itself that. Well, oh my goodness, not in and of itself that he was a man.
So you got it
right.
Because I said that was true.
Well, as a man, he doesn't use his divine authority.
Right.
So he's a man even now, right? But yet he's in the state of exaltation.
There's nothing humiliating about being a man.
No.
God created men.
Yeah.
He said it was good.
Yeah.
He said it was very good. But I got that wrong because I said it was true. No, it's like you said, because he doesn't use his power as God.
Yeah.
That's the humiliation.
But I think that's a great point. I'm glad you brought it up. So it's not just that when he was up in heaven, then he was exalted. When he came down to earth, he was humiliated. And, now he's back up in heaven, he's exalted again. No, that's really not it.
Well, and I like the thought that you're right. He's still a man up in there.
Yeah.
We're going to be men in heaven, men and women, and that'll be a good thing.
Yeah.
No, it's not the humanity, but it was that he didn't use the power he had as God.
Yes.
All right.
Yet he's always God. So he never stopped being God. He just
I
know it's
didn't use the power though.
Yes.
Yeah.
So we're talking about two different things. We're talking about two things that go hand in hand, and we're getting way off subject probably. But you have the humiliation. It relates humiliation, exaltation. But I think what's also important, you have these two natures.
Yeah.
So you have this that Jesus is both true God and true man.
Yeah.
So he doesn't cease to be, when he becomes incarnate, when he takes on our flesh, when he becomes man, he doesn't cease to be God.
No.
And just like today, he doesn't cease to be man, which, I bet that's mind-blowing.
I like that.
That he became one of us, not just for, his 33 years or so here on earth, but even now, we're bearing those wounds of the cross, for us as still God and man. Incredible.
I like it too because he knows he knows what the weakness of the flesh is, even though he's been tempted in every which way as we have. So it's not like he's up in heaven saying, I remember once a long time ago what that was like. No, he's I understand what you're going through because I still have that flesh. I know what that's all about.
Yeah. Yeah, what a comfort as our high priest, as the one we pray in his name, like we talked about last
week. Like us in every way, yeah.
So when you look at the creed then, the humiliation, things like being conceived by the Holy Spirit, that conception, and born of the Virgin Mary, suffering under Pontius Pilate, crucified, died, buried. I mean, we can see, he's not using his divine power there. He's allowing these things to happen. They're all part of God's foreknowledge and plan, right, and purpose. But yet, his state of humiliation.
Well, because here you got the Almighty God who's present everywhere.
Yeah.
In fact, he's actually with us right here today on this radio show, as he is with everyone who's listening to us at this moment. And yet, he was stuck away in the womb of a woman.
Incredible that he would allow himself to do that. And be born like us.
Or worse, stuck in a hole in the ground.
Yeah. For sure.
Okay,
buried.
I'm sorry.
That's part of it too. But that exaltation then.
Well, now, wait a second. Why? Well, go ahead.
Okay,
what's the next thing?
Well, the next thing, he was crucified, died, was buried. He descended into hell.
Well, that sounds like humiliation to me. Isn't that where you go? You go to suffer.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Descended to hell, third day rose again from the dead.
That's a bad place.
Ascended to heaven, sits at God's right hand.
All right, those are all exaltation.
It's all exaltation. But what's the, what is the deal? And I think that's the whole point here. Is going into hell, is that part of Jesus' humiliation or part of his exaltation? Is he using his divine authority and power or not when he descends into hell? What's the deal?
Pastor Clark, does the Bible give an answer to that?
Well, yes, it does. I'm glad you asked, Pastor Lukowski. But, you know, just, I mean, I think the reason we think, what's this doing here? Because throughout the scriptures, especially in the Gospels, hell is not a good place,
no,
right?
No, it's not.
We need to recognize
no,
that.
No.
But yet it's a real place. Jesus, Matthew 25, he calls it this eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. Jesus talks about hell a lot, actually. He talks about, you know, the place where the fire doesn't go out and the worm doesn't die weeping and gnashing of teeth. This chasm even he talks about between heaven certainly and hell. But, you know, also we recognize that he doesn't want anyone to go to hell, right? Desires that all be saved and come to a knowledge of the truth. So having all that in mind, why does Jesus descend into hell? And why is that part of his exaltation? Just a handful of passages talks about that descent into hell, right?
Is there actually a handful?
There is not many. So
okay.
There's the one we want to look at today from 1 Peter. Colossians chapter 2 talks about just, you know, brief,
have you got it there?
Yeah, 2 verse 15. Oh, you know, I don't have it in front of me, but.
What, you want me to look it up?
And then maybe you could even include Psalm 16 verse 10 as part of that as well.
What's Colossians 2?
But again, it's 2? Not yet. Yeah, 2 verse 15. But again, not. I'm not sure this is going to add a whole lot of clarity, John, so don't get too excited. But again,
go
ahead.
He disarmed the rulers and authorities and put them to open shame by triumphing over them and him. I see that.
Yeah.
Where would those authorities be? They would be in hell. They were. Okay.
Yeah, so again, this triumph. Okay, so again. Part of an exaltation. So I think
putting
we're
them to shame,
there, right?
too.
Putting
yeah,
them to
yeah.
shame. And then we have, you know, Psalm 16, verse 10, which we kind of look at that in terms of the resurrection as well, but this connection of the descent into hell and also the resurrection as well. But we look at Psalm 16, verse 10, as I turn to it in my wife's Bible that I'm still using.
Why are you
Lisa,
using the pink Bible?
It was handy.
Okay.
It's on radio. No one can see that it's pink.
Oh, yeah. Well, we should have mentioned that.
So Psalm 60, verse 10, for you will not abandon my soul to Sheol,
let
your holy ones see corruption. So I think there, too.
That, and Sheol is the Hebrew word for hell.
So it's Jesus isn't being abandoned there or seeing corruption there in hell. No, it's for some other reason. So Jesus doesn't stay in the tomb dead. But also, even in his descent of hell, he's not going to be tortured, right?
Okay.
So let's read this 1 Peter passage, too. This is
wait a second.
Okay.
So this isn't purgatory? I thought this was the passage for purgatory.
No.
That these people are in purgatory.
Well, I mean, I think it's pretty clear that it's hell. And I think one of these...
All right.
I think... This 1 Peter passage will kind of give some clarity to it, too.
I agree with you. It's a lot clearer than those other two passages. But now I lost my place. Oh, wait a second. There it is. I've got it. 1 Peter. Where do you want me to start reading, Matt?
Well, let's see. 1 Peter. Let's see here. What do we got? Chapter
3.
Chapter 3, verses about just 18 and 19.
All right. For Christ also suffered for us, the righteous for the unrighteous, and he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit. So we've got the whole crucifixion, resurrection stuff here.
Yes.
And here's the key verse, in which he went and proclaimed to the spirits in prison, because they formerly did not obey when God's... that's it, isn't it? He went and proclaimed to the spirits in prison. That's it. Is there more? You want me to read more?
That's it. No, I mean, you can read on, you know, and it talks about Noah and the days of the flood and details like that. But I think that's pretty good.
Well, it is, but it's very confusing.
Yeah.
He went and proclaimed to the spirits in prison.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah, so Jesus goes there. It doesn't say that he's going there to give them a second chance, right?
No, nothing said about that.
It doesn't say that he's going there to suffer. Jesus' suffering isn't mentioned there at all.
Well,
right?
In fact, that other passage talked about triumph.
Yeah,
so that
triumph,
would seem to be
just
contrary to...
Exactly. You know, and I think... You know, the context of 1 Peter 2, we want to keep in mind, Peter's writing to this group of people, Christians, who are being persecuted because of the faith.
Yeah.
They're living in what's now Turkey. They live in Asia Minor. They're living in a place where they're suffering for not worshiping pagan gods, for not worshiping even Caesar himself. They're in a living hell.
Okay.
And Peter writes to them to encourage them. And part of what he says is this verse, to encourage them with this verse, that here... He triumphs, right? He highlights three truths in those verses, right? Jesus died.
Okay.
Right? He was made alive. And then he also preached to the spirits in prison. In prison there in hell. He died. He was made alive. Descended to hell. Those key things. And that's really written, I think, to encourage those people in what is now modern day Turkey. So we have this, I think what's helpful too is this hymn that Walther wrote. So the first president of our synod wrote this Easter hymn, right?
Oh yeah, yeah,
and,
okay.
This one, he's risen, and I think Walther's
he's
kind
risen,
of... Yeah,
he's
exactly,
risen,
yeah. So Walther kind of invites us to picture what that was like in hell, what things were like in hell on Good Friday.
Ah, okay, okay.
So he is the stanza, the foe is triumphant. Satan was triumphant when on Calvary, the Lord of creation was nailed to a tree, you know. You can almost picture the party being thrown
yeah,
out, right?
Yeah.
Satan's domain, the
We've
host
been trying
shouted
for
and
the
jeered.
History of the world to kill him.
Yep. Jesus was slain whom the evil ones feared. But then he goes on, okay? And he talks about that party in hell being pretty short, because the next stanza says, but short was their triumph. The Savior arose, death, hell, and Satan, he vanquished his foes. The conquering Lord, he lifts his banner on high. He lives, yes, he lives, and will never more die. You know, this banner he lifts on high, this banner of victory. And I think that we can begin to see why he goes into hell. You know, that banner of victory, to proclaim triumph that Colossians talks about, to talk to those spirits in prison even, he goes, yeah, and as victor, not to suffer. And I think that's so important. You know, he doesn't go into hell to suffer on our behalf. That would just say, to me, that's saying the cross wasn't enough suffering.
Right.
The cross wasn't good enough.
No, suffer more.
Jesus had to suffer just a little more to make your salvation sure.
And you probably should too.
Yeah. Well, yeah. We're back to purgatory, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
And no, Jesus suffering his death is sufficient for all.
It is finished.
It is finished. You know, he's not going to hell to give a second chance. It's not figurative either. He really descends into hell with that conquering banner of victory. He descends in that state of exaltation. And so I think that, you know, what is, you know, for our lives today then, and for those people, you know, that Paul's writing to who are in a living hell, when they feel like they're in a living hell, when we feel like we're in a living hell sometimes because of different circumstances, whether it's, you know, outside of us or things in our lives, we have this confidence that Jesus conquered hell. He's conquered the literal hell, but he's also conquered the figurative hells in our life too by his rising and by his victory. So kind of the answer is descends into hell, part of the exaltation, the divine power, and he goes to proclaim victory. Victory over Satan, over hell, over death. And he goes right into the devil's domain, hell itself, to do that. Any comments?
Well, I like the picture you gave us. I could just see the devils and Satan. They're all having their big party.
Yeah,
and then,
yep.
Hey, somebody's at the door.
Someone wasn't invited to this party.
Who's at the door? Oh, no. He's risen. Jesus. He's alive.
Wait a second.
But I the key thing is that I like the fact that he was victor over all these things for you and me. That's the neat thing. Like you said, he's going to hell. For love and back. Yeah. I know what you said in the thing.
Yeah, he goes to hell and back out of love for us. He does it not to suffer, but to claim victory. Like I think you said before, John, you know, he goes to the devil's capital city, right? To show total victory, total defeat over Satan. And that's exactly what Jesus did for us. So hopefully some clarity about another kind of difficult teaching.
Me.
One that we say every time we say the creed. But yeah, again, descend into hell, part of that victory of Jesus for us. All right. Well, we'll see what we come up with next week.
Who knows what hard passages we'll take on.
We'll try to top this one. We'll see. It's not going to be easy. But we'll invite you to listen again next week. Wrestling with the Basics.